Okay, so why the switch from DTU to PubApp?
Ma'am, actually, I started preparing for civil services and I took public administration as my optional. So over time, I developed an inclination towards public administration. And then I thought, why not do a formal degree in the same? That's why I did master's in public administration, ma'am.
Got it. Okay. So tell me one thing. Why? So in your interests, you've written something. You've written that you like diary writing, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So why and can you, do you understand or is it just a hobby or do you have an idea of the underlying reasons from the mental health perspective of diary writing, etc.?
Ma'am, I write it as a personal experience. I mean, as a, basically a taskmaster wherein I jot down the things to be done tomorrow. I basically use it as a taskmaster kind of thing, ma'am. But yes, diary writing is also very important for mental health perspective, ma'am, because it helps us in better handling or managing our emotions like stress, anxiety, or the relationship with other people. So I think, yes, ma'am, diary writing has a lot of positives and mental health is one of them.
Okay. So coming back to mental health. So overall, what we've seen is there has sort of been a rising discussion around mental health, etc. in the country and in fact, globally for that matter. So considering the recent suicides and everything, right? Again, let's talk about very accomplished people committing suicides and, you know, stuff like that. What is your take on how can you combat something like that? Or how can you as an administrator figure out a way to make things better for such people?
Ma'am, there can be a number of ways by which an administrator can ensure that there is better health in his or her own district, ma'am. Okay. Firstly, spreading awareness about mental health and treating it not as a taboo, but like any other problem, health issue in the society. Second would be the launch of various helpline numbers, ma'am. For example, we have Sanjeevani helpline and a kind of district helpline, which helps in counseling the people in their own native language, ma'am. Thirdly, I think by associating schools, colleges, and various other educational institutions wherein the mental health can be focused upon, and we can have a lot of sports, gaming activities, yoga, meditation, etc. to deal with this crisis, ma'am. Ma'am, I think apart from all these things, changing the lifestyle wherein the people are more meeting with each other or going to parks, ma'am, making just very small changes in their day-to-day life can also ensure a better mental health, ma'am.
Okay. But again, so what exactly, I would prefer that if you actually go on with, you know, starting with what is the, why do you think this crisis has actually originated in the first place? And then kind of working on the solution, because that would make the context a little more clearer. So can you do that?
Sure, ma'am. Ma'am, there are various reasons for mental health becoming such a concern today, which is the rise in the number of suicides, stress, anxiety, depression in today's youth. Ma'am, the numbers, the reasons can be one, a very high increase in competition, leading to high expectations from not only peers, but also family and friends. Secondly, ma'am, a high rise in inequality in the society. Thirdly, very common access to social media and internet, wherein it can be a major source of the mis campaigns or the false campaigns going on. Ma'am, fourthly, we have moved on to a very materialistic lifestyle, wherein the physical exercises And all these kind of things have taken a backseat. Apart from that, ma'am, the nuclear family setup that we have moved to, especially in the urban parts of the country, is also one of the major reasons. Ma'am, as an administrator, depending on the area wherein I'll be serving, I'll first like to find out the major challenges which are very peculiar to that area.
Okay, fine. Let me do one thing. Let's start with picking up an area now that you've mentioned that you want to be area specific. Let's talk about Delhi. I'm sure you're pretty much aware of how things happen in one. Delhi is a metro city. Things that you've talked about, say lifestyle, nuclear family, etc., is something that we see a lot more in metro cities. So can you help with tackling these? I'll do one thing. I'll start pointing out all the points that you've mentioned, and then you can give me a solution on every single one of those points, right?
Sure, ma'am.
Yeah. So the first thing you said was rising competition. So how will you combat that in a country like that? And preferably try to give solutions that have already are not already in the works. I would want you to have a slightly newer angle to the whole problem.
Ma'am, although increase in competition is not bad per se, but the failure and the stigma of getting failed is a problem which leads to mental health problems. So as a DM, this would be one of my responsibilities, that the society start celebrating risk taking, start celebrating attempting rather than successing or getting failed. Ma'am, this can be done in a number of ways, by having various seminars, counseling, or having various assembly. I mean, using the school assemblies, wherein a number of examples can be given by a number of known personalities, wherein we can say that okay, these are the people who have also failed in their lives, but still they didn't give up. They went on improving themselves and later on became successful in themselves. Ma'am, I think this would be the major thing that I would like to do here. And also, secondly, counseling their parents as well as teachers, so that the whole ecosystem wherein the students, wherein the youngsters live, can change to a large extent.
Mm-hmm. Inequality.
Ma'am, inequality per se can't be dealt in a very short-term perspective. So I think in the long term, we can go in for various methods wherein we can tax, we can have wealth tax for the wealthy people of the society. And herein, I would like to focus about the accessibility of opportunities, whether the person is from a wealthy strata of the society or from a poor strata, irrespective of the caste, religion, or wealth, the easy accessibility and equal accessibility to all regarding the opportunities are concerned, ma'am. I think this can be the major solution.
Okay. I'll just skip a couple here, and I'll just want to ask you, how do you want to work on the nuclear family aspect, considering people actually have migrated to a city, right? The whole idea is, and even with the nuclear family, parents are generally away from home, both of them are working. And it's mostly not possible for parents to get the elders of the family home for whatever reasons, right? So how do you plan to combat this nuclear family issue that you've mentioned?
Ma'am, I think technology today has blurred all the distances. So even if the grandparents are not there at home, present at home, the children or their grandchildren can connect to them through various video calls, through telephonic conversations. So that, ma'am, whenever they are alone or whenever they feel sad or depressed about a thing, they can have someone to talk to. And plus, we have also seen that having grandparents inculcates a number of values in the children. So I think we can have such kind of arrangement. Secondly, ma'am, but this can come from the society itself. Secondly, ma'am, incentivizing the parents to go and visit the old age homes, which are there are a number of old age homes in Delhi. So having weekly visits or fortnightly visits also inculcates a sense of belongingness to not only the children, but also the people who are living there. Apart from these two initiatives, ma'am, I think going to the park, having interacting with the seniors there, and sharing one's own life's problems with elders also would also help in curbing the mental health disease, ma'am.
Okay. The next thing that I will want to ask you is about the rising intolerance in the society that also people are talking about these days. So how do you think that, you know, even so, see, let's talk about, say, 20 years back, where people would very a lot of people think that, say, 20 years back, if something was said to somebody, people would not have taken that much of an offense, and even if it was politically incorrect. But today, anything even said in a jest can actually be taken in an absolutely wrong fashion, right? So how do you plan to tackle if something of that sort happens in your district? If something like that comes up, say, a stand-up comedian says something wherein he basically resides in your district, or is a very famous figure in your district, and then suddenly, you know, there are a lot of issues happening around it. There are demonstrations happening outside his house, etc., etc. How do you plan to tackle such a situation?
Ma'am, answering to the first part of the question about the rising intolerance, I think the major reason for this rising intolerance in people is basically the lack of or the inadequate emotional intelligence that is there in the people. They are already full of emotions, that whenever another person comes and says anything offensive or even in light humor, they are not able to take it in a very positive gesture. Secondly, coming to the second part of the question, if such a comedian comes and makes a political statement and there are demonstrations, the first and foremost responsibility, I think, of being as a DM would be ensuring the safety of the comedian, by giving him or her proper police protection or some other kind of protection that he or she might require. Secondly, ma'am, I think having a positive campaign about how in a democracy we all have a freedom of expression, and by being free to express ourselves, there is a very thin line between harming one's dignity and having a very light humor on the said personality. So I think there should be an awareness about the same, ma'am. But I think it's a very long-term measure wherein we can involve the schools, the colleges, the various educational institutions, as well as the religious leaders and local level leaders, ma'am, who can come up and who can say that dissent and having made some such political comments is a part and parcel of the Indian civilization. And by curbing that, we are actually doing a harm to Indian democracy. We are not taking it in the right spirit, ma'am.
Okay. So just a tiny follow-up on this. So remember when this movie Padmavat had come out, right? And there were political leaders who had commented on getting the actress's head to them and other people being rewarded lakhs and lakhs of rupees, etc. How would you manage something, I mean, considering that you've said that political leaders have to be made aware, etc., how do you believe a political leader can be controlled in a situation like our country? And considering political leaders generally have the ability to sway crowds, right? How do you want to manage this?
Ma'am, in the Padmavat episode, had I been there, or I think the DM who was posted there, the first thing that he did was to have a meeting between the producers of the film the various stakeholders associated with the film and the people and the political leaders who are making such extreme statements on ground. Ma'am, if I am not wrong, then one special screening was also arranged for such kind of people so that they can see for themselves that this is not against their own political ideologies, etc. Ma'am, I think such steps ensure that there is a solidarity or there is cooperation in the society. Ma'am, if such a situation arises, then firstly, our main motive is to, I mean, in the short term, to give security to not only the actresses, the film producers, but also ensuring that the people who are going to watch that film are also safe in the cinema. Secondly, ma'am, having such peace committees in hand wherein they can come and talk over the issue is also one of a very right step that can be taken in such cases. Thirdly, ma'am, I think overall, the education or awareness level of the political parties should increase so that there is an internal democracy amongst themselves and they can ensure that in spite of brickbatting on these issues, they can move on to some other, I mean, bigger issues that are challenging our society. And ma'am, also ensuring that if such a broadcasting right is being given to a film, then BCCI or the film fraternity that is certifying the film as adult or as universal can also be made accountable for the same, ma'am. And I think there are proper safeguards right now wherein they have to take into mind that the said film is not against the whim, the ideologies or beliefs of a certain community, ma'am.
Take it. Perfect, Mupur. Thank you so much. And I think Shweta will take it from here. Okay.
Hello, ma'am.
So Aditi ma'am has given you a lot of situation reaction questions. So I want to follow up on that only. A few questions related to that. So you said that regarding the lockdown period and everything which is going on, right? And diary writing is one of the thing where person can at least communicate with someone, even if it is a diary. You would have heard about an actor, a very famous actor, Sushant Singh Rajput, committing suicide at this moment of time. There might be some personal reasons regarding that. So so I want to connect this with your graduation background. You are an electronics and communication engineer, right? So how will you use that communication knowledge or technology in curbing or giving certain solution in this moment of lockdown and whatever things are going on in this movement? So how will you utilize that knowledge in this perspective?
Ma'am, if I'm not wrong, the question is about using of technology.
And, using of technology or using of your communication knowledge itself. You can go for the philosophical background also on that, and as well as your technological. So I want you from both the sides.
In handling the lockdown period, right, ma'am?
Yeah.
Ma'am, that too as a DM, as ma'am has said, or that...
Normal, just as a normal engineer. You are engineering background, and as a student, how are you going to deal? As a learner of that, communication technology.
Ma'am, this lockdown period was no doubt very difficult for every individual. But at the same time, this period gave me an opportunity to brush up my skills of the engineering background. Ma'am, there were a number of online courses that were made available, either free or paid courses by the universities around the world that could have been taken up through the use of electronics and communication medium. Secondly, ma'am, the major motive of the lockdown was to contain the corona pandemic. And Arogya Setu is also one of a very important link in the same for contact tracing. So Arogya Setu is second, ma'am. Thirdly, ma'am, I would here like to talk about the use of geofencing technique that the government used so as to curb the movement of the people who are quarantined or self-isolated at home. Herein, as an engineer, ma'am, The Arogya Setu app was recently made open source by the government, and it was said that if any malfunction is there, we can report the same to the government. So as an engineer, I also went through the source code of the same, and just to find out, I mean, if there is any such a loophole on the law. But fortunately, ma'am, there was no such thing. Fourthly, ma'am, this EC technology or the communication on the internet gave us a very respite from the physical distancing or from being confined in the homes, because we had access to Netflix and a lot of other video streaming apps. The gaming apps were also available online. So I think, ma'am, in order to beat isolation, stress, anxiety, the internet came handy to a lot of youngsters like me.
Okay, very good. I expected this answer from you being an engineer, because I myself is an electronics engineer. Okay, so now coming back to your this thing. So your option was public administration, right? I want you to justify your public administration knowledge in this ongoing thing, like the corona pandemic, which is going on. So how will you use, or what kind of knowledges have you gained from your public administration thing in order to deal with such circumstances if at any time you become a DM and you are facing such situation?
Ma'am, there are a number of ways through which I can use the knowledge of public administration in containing the whole pandemic. Number one, communication. Ma'am, communicating with my team members as well as with the general public is of paramount importance, because this pandemic has caused a number of fear as well as uncertainty in the governance mechanism. Secondly, ma'am, e-governance, wherein using the technology, the civil society, as well as the private establishments along with the government to better administer on ground, ma'am. Thirdly, I think, ma'am, better using all the tiers of the government, be it related to police. Hello?
Yeah, no, continue.
Be it related to policing or civil society, ma'am, or related to the taking help of local volunteers on ground, local youth volunteers. That can be used, ma'am.
Okay. So after coming to this now, something very personal to you. So, in your opinion, what is the most striking feature which you consider is, or not striking feature, but the most striking point for empowerment of women? Just one point. And what do you think that is a must for empowering a woman?
Ma'am, I think the safety and security is the most... ma'am, because I think unless and until a woman feels secure, be it her own household or the society or the workplace itself, she can't give wings to her own dreams or ambitions, ma'am. Herein, talking from till when, I mean, talking of the times when she's still a fetus to the times when she becomes an adult, I think we all must ensure, the government must ensure that she is feeling safe as well as secured.
Okay, Nupal, but this is, don't you think so that this is again something which is given to the women rather than the women taking it themselves, right? So it should come from within. Don't you think so that rather than bringing this empowerment and talking about ending the patriarchy and everything which we talk about, what is your opinion should be the stand of the whole society? I mean, don't you think so that teaching the people the importance of equality of women is more important rather than providing women something? What is your take on this? Whether something should be given to women or it should be ingrained in the society? And if it has to be ingrained, how are you going to ensure that?
Definitely, ma'am. For empowering a woman in true sense, it would lead the change to come from within the society. But ma'am, changing the society from within is a very long drawn process. And we have to take in the help of such give and take mechanisms in the meanwhile so as to fast track the whole mechanism, ma'am. So I think the ends is same. It's just about the means and it's just about fast tracking the whole process of women empowerment, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. So that my last question will be regarding your ACIU 2 exam. So I think it's related to Intelligence Bureau, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So when did you join that? I mean, how much time had been passed since you joined it?
Ma'am, I joined as an ACIO in Intelligence Bureau in last November. That is November 2019. And right now I'm undergoing training in the Bureau itself.
Okay, so considering the intelligence connection in the country, what do you feel are the most the basic challenges in the whole intelligence network in the country? What are those, in your opinion?
Ma'am, I think there are a number of challenges. One, India being a very diverse country, there are a number of, any number of caste, creed, religion, region, etc. Secondly, ma'am, the rising role of social media and moving on to new types of warfares that are being generated in the all across the world, ma'am. Thirdly, I think the major challenge is the changing of methodology of how the terrorism works or how the anti-state actors work on ground. Makes it more complex or more difficult for the operative on ground to collect intelligence about the same, ma'am.
Okay, so what should be the main methodology, or you can say standard operating procedure for this connecting the whole intelligence network in just one one go or in one line? What should be the most perfect way for that?
Ma'am, I think having a communication network, which is not only connected the state headquarters to the national headquarters, but also connecting them to the last mile outpost that is there in the country. As to have a faster mechanism of communication, a faster method of message delivery, I think is the major thing that I think would help in intelligence collection, ma'am. Secondly, ma'am, I think we should now work on not only collection, but also analyzing the same. That is moving on towards actionable intelligence, as our Honorable Home Minister also pointed out some time back. So for that, ma'am, basic awareness generation amongst all the Intelligence Bureau people, better training of how to handle not only the changing circumstances, but also the changing challenges, as well as the technological upgradations. Equipping them with state-of-art technological tools, as well as training them how to use them on the ground, ma'am. I think these are the two major things.
Okay. And my last question will be, tell me, what do you think that you have in you? Tell me about your three strengths which you consider that... which will justify you as an IS officer or as a human, good human being. So what are your three strengths personally?
I'm as a good IS officer, I think my major strengths are one, leadership quality, as I was the head girl academy captain at school. And I also was the chief liaison officer during some training phase an Intelligence Bureau, ma'am. Secondly, I think I'm very hardworking and efficient in nature. Thirdly, ma'am, I think I have a lot of patience and perseverance because I believe that good things take time to develop and to happen in life. And so is the reality in the current scenario at the national level also, ma'am.
Hello, Nupur. How are you?
Namaskar, sir. I'm good, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So, Nupur, as my colleagues have ask you a lot of things, so I just want to play a mental game with you. So I'll tell you the rules of the game and then you and me will play. So at the very start, you and me are unknown to each other as it is. You don't know me, I don't know you. That's the basic assumption. The rule is, you have got a lottery of, let's say, rupees 50,000. Now you have the option of keeping all the money, or you can share that amount in whichever proportion you want, from 0 to 100% with me. That's up to you. And you don't know me. You don't know my background, where I am from, nothing at all. Once you do the transfer, I have the same option. I have the option of keeping all the money that you gave me, or I can give it back to you in the proportion I like, 0 to 100%. And this game will continue. Okay. So Nupu, now you have won a lottery. It's a lottery. No hard work, nothing. You just random lottery you won. Now you have 50,000. Now what will you do?
Sir, should I tell you the amount that I would be passing on?
Yeah. Or no amount. And there will be no counter questions. The game will stop.
Sir, no amount.
Sorry?
Sir, is there any criteria? I mean, do I know you or?
No, you don't know me at all. You don't know me at all. You have never seen my face. It's just a random game.
Sir, in that case, I would not give you any amount. I mean, my answer would be no amount.
Okay, thank you. Game over. The second question is, have you heard a term called jobless growth?
Yes, sir.
What is this?
Sir, here in it signifies about an economic condition wherein the growth in the GDP numbers is happening, but the same or proportional growth in jobs is not happening, or rather the number of jobs that are available in the economy are decreasing at a rate. So that is jobless growth.
Okay. Do you think India is suffering from this situation?
Sir, to some extent, yes, sir, I believe that India is facing a jobless growth because our GDP is rising to, very handsomely, but not the employment conditions are being generated at the same time. But at the same time, sir, the government as well as, has come up with a number of initiatives so as to increase the jobs in the country.
So, Nukul, give me three reasons why India is facing this problem of jobless growth. Just three reasons. Very brief.
Sir, one, the number of jobs in the services sector has decreased. Sir, second, the share of manufacturing in the economy has more or less remained same in the Indian economy. Sir, thirdly, the distress employment or the hidden unemployment in agriculture is very large, which also leads to a kind of unemployment in the economy and which is also said to be a part of the jobless growth, sir.
Okay. Nukul, next question is, have you heard a term called LFPR, Labor Force Participation Rate?
Yes,
and
sir.
With respect to labor force participation rate, I want to specifically ask you about the women labor force participation rate. What is the situation of women LFPR? And how is this LFPR impacting the overall unemployment in the economy?
Sir, LFPR is basically means the number of people who are searching for job and who are already employed in the economy. Sir, in the case of women, the female LFPR has unfortunately decreased to around 22% according to the last estimates. Sir, I'm sorry, I have skipped the last question which you asked regarding the same.
Reason for such a low woman LFPR?
Sir, basically there is both a supply as well as the demand problem as far as the women LFPR is concerned. Sir, because of the rise in incomes in some of the families and because some of the females are going in for higher studies, we have seen that they have opted out of the employment cycle that has led to a demand side problem of LFPR. Sir, but moving on to the second dimension of the question, I think the major reasons are the lack of adequate economic opportunities present to women, especially in tier 2, tier 3 cities. Secondly, sir, the lack of equal wages which are associated with women in the economy are also one of the reasons. So thirdly, the safety and security of women in transportation or at the workplaces is also one of the major reasons why females are not even opting to work in various organizations.
Thank you, Nupur. Now, the next thing is, have you heard the concept of missing women?
Sir, I have heard the concept, but I'm not very sure about it. If you allow me to guess,
it's okay. You can guess. You can give me a guess answer.
Missing women, I think, is the term which is associated with the number of women that get killed before a son child is born to a family. Sir, I think this is the definition.
Okay, thank you so much, Nupur. Now I would like to pass on to VP sir. VP sir?
Yeah. Okay, Nupur, I've got a couple of questions. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Namaskar, sir.
Namaskar. So, Nupur, let's first talk about something which is happening around India. So, India is in conflict with China, Nepal, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Pakistan, of course. Now, there is a unique situation. Russia is a friend of China. All the major, arms that is there with China is actually sourced from Russia. India has traditionally been a friend with Russia. America now is offering all modern equipments to India. Now, which way should India go? Should India go towards America side, or should India continue with Russia? Your take.
Sir, I believe that if India is importing such arms and technologies, then it should diversify its imports basket. Sir, it should deal with both Russia as well as USA, sir. Having it just from one country would, I think, align us to a major bloc in itself. Sir, by having it from both the countries would reject us as non-aligned in nature, as well as, sir, it will give us a strategic autonomy. I mean, we'll be at a much bigger or better bargaining power as far as both the countries are concerned, sir.
Now that you have talked about non-alignment, I mean, the philosophy, do you think that non-alignment philosophy is even relevant? Because the countries the major countries who are there in non-aligned movement or the member of non-aligned that association all have got a very bad reputation. They have got dictators, military leaders and everything. And in no way they are non-aligned. All are either aligned to China or Russia or America. So don't you think it's such a waste?
Sir, I'm very sorry. I would like to differ from your stand here, wherein I think that non-aligned movement is not just about aligning ourselves with a said country or said bloc, but it's also about coming up of like-minded countries so as to deal with the issues which are affecting them, sir, that can be related to the economy or climate change, terrorism, etc. Sir, and coming to the second part of the question, I think that foreign policy is also always dictated by the national interest. So whenever a nation's national interests are better aligned, are getting better served by aligning to Russia or China, they'll do so. And whenever the opposite is happening, they'll align with America. So, sir, I think being a part of national non-alignment movement is actually a strength, and it gives us a kind of autonomy so as to have a relationship on good terms with both the blocs.
Okay. Now let's talk about this is a unique country called Afghanistan. There yes. had been hostility. We know that, there was a plane hijack and then we had to release a couple of dreaded terrorists. Now, recently, the spokesperson of Taliban said that Kashmir is India's internal matter. And as Islamic Caliphate or Islamic State, we don't believe in interfering in others' internal matter. Now, how do you see this? Is this a change in stance or something new has happened?
Sir, I think both. It's partially a win for the India's diplomatic channels or track-to-track-three diplomacy that we have with Afghanistan, including the Taliban leaders, sir. Sir, and secondly, something new has also emerged on the geopolitical arena. Sir, the rise of Islamic State in the Afghanistan or in that region has given a kind of competition to Taliban. Sir, they are coming up with a peace pact with USA, and now starting with the intra-Afghanistan talks is also something new in nature, which has given a leeway. I think which has given this way towards the change of hearts. Taliban recognizes that as Taliban is concerned, so we are having major investment there. And the humanitarian ties, people-to-people contacts are also very high as far as Indo-Afghanistan relationship are concerned. So Taliban is just recognizing the same, sir.
Okay. So let's talk a bit about something internal. You are from Delhi, Narela, right?
Yes, sir.
Recently, I mean, in December, there was this huge protest in Shaheen Bagh, right? And because of that protest, the route from Delhi to Faridabad was almost blocked. And there used to be huge you know, traffic issues between Delhi to Faridabad and Noida to Delhi. And because of that, the pollution level was rising. Now, this is the situation. Now, as per NGT, any person or agency or a company, if causing pollution, should be penalized, right? Now, shouldn't NGT penalize Shaheen Bagh protesters for pollution in Delhi because of this traffic situation? There was a huge wastage of fossil fuel, and that was actually culminating into high pollution in December, January. Your take.
Sir, I don't think that NGT should go and penalize the Shaheen Bagh protesters. Sir, one, because we are a democratic country and everyone has the freedom of expression. Strikes also are a part of it because they were very peaceful in nature. Sir, although that led to a number of traffic jams and congestion as well as inconvenience to various people living here, sir, but I think a better traffic management could have been the solution.
No, but
sir,
you can't have traffic management. There's just one route, and that was blocked. So what exactly would you do? You can't ask somebody from Noida to go to Gurgaon and then from there go to you know, Faridabad. That also is not possible because Delhi Gurgaon is already have got bottleneck in spite of having two routes.
Yes, sir.
So there's absolutely no way. You don't have roads. And they blocked it. And they are creating pollution. Indirectly, they are the reason behind the pollution. And mind you, just to give you an example, that if I throw my you know, puja waste, I mean, you know, agarbatti and dhoop and all, in Yamuna, I'll be fined for 5,000 rupees and 6 months jail. It's just a packet of flowers and then puja waste and 5,000 rupees and 6 months jail. What about them? That's my question. You can't have traffic management. Let's be very fair about it.
Sir, herein, when the NGT or when the Delhi government is penalizing one for disposing the religious waste, sir, in that, sir, that's a very source or pointed source wherein we can say that, okay, this is the major reason for this pollution. Sir, but in case of Shaheen Bagh protest, the protesters over there are already bereaved from the government because of some underlying issues, sir. And on top of it, penalizing them would have just exacerbated the whole problem to another extent. Sir, I think that rather than penalizing them, the government or the NGT could have said that please relocate to some other area or to some other
that option was given by the way
so that
that, you can have that no that option was already given to them and they flatly refused it. Okay, now the next question and the last one from my side before I'll ask one supplementary question. Now there was a lockdown for 3 months. Yamuna was clean.
Yes, sir.
Atmosphere of Delhi was clean, very nice.
Yes, sir.
And so such was the situation across the country. Now, my question: we have got this Earth Summit and every year summit and all summit 1, 2, whatever. I mean, number of summits. Shouldn't there be a mandatory lockdown of 1 month across the globe to clean the environment?
Sir, the lockdown herein was imposed because of a very unprecedented situation. And we have also seen a number of economic as well as social consequences of the lockdown, wherein there was an increase in hunger. There are global reports saying that 6 crore of the people can go down below the poverty line in the South Asian region. But there was a silver lining of environmental restoration. So I think rather than having a lockdown mandatorily across the globe, we should work on inducing or incentivizing behavioral change across the globe.
So but Nupur, that's not happening. That's why I'm asking a very pointed question. That's not happening. Point number two, I'm not suggesting that there should be abrupt lockdown. Declare it. Every year, December would be a lockdown. What? I mean, like, everybody would be aware that from 1st December till 31st December, there would be lockdown. Or maybe since it's a New Year time, maybe 1st January to 31st of January, there would be lockdown. Maybe something like that. Well, every year it's a set thing. So everybody would be aware. So there would not be any issue of a hunger thing because government would take care of everything. Now your answer.
Sir, if the said lockdown is taking care of not only the lives, but also livelihoods of all the people across the globe and is then improving the environment, then I think we should go for it, sir. But it's very difficult to have both of them together, both the livelihood as well as the environment. Sir, if somehow the globe will go both of them, then I think we should go for it. But I personally feel it to be a very far-fetched dream.
Okay. My last question, that's a supplementary one. Have you heard of somebody called Anne Frank?
Yes, sir. So she was the... Yep, so please. She's a famous diary writer who wrote the diary of a young girl during World War II, sir.
Okay, the most celebrated diary that was published, apart from Anne Frank's diary.
Sir, there is also a collection of diaries of Gandhiji's personal assistant. Sir, I'm forgetting his name, but it was also widely acclaimed and was very famous. Sir, in recent times, the Wuhan Diaries by Fang is very famous today. In the whole corona pandemic, sir.
Right, Nupur. So that's all from our interview perspective. Now we'll start with the feedback. Aditi would start, and the same sequence would follow. Aditi, and then finally, in the end, I'll come.
One good thing. I'll start with the good first. Okay. So your manner of speaking is very nice. I like the way you're talking. I like how you're staying calm throughout the interview. I didn't see you flinch or get nervous at any point of time. All of that was very nice. Your knowledge is wonderful. You know a lot around most of the things. Just a few things that I think you really need to work on is first, when the question is personal, as in when your opinion is being asked for, or when, let's just start from the first question, which was tell me about yourself, right? You were fairly, it was already something that everybody new, right? It was most of the things that you talked about were already there in your dad. If it would have been nicer if you could give me a little more insight into who you are as a person. You just told me about your educational background and where you're working right now, and your age and the city you belong to, right? But if you could just say, add something which helps me form an image of the person that you are, which is other than your job, that is, so then that would have been obviously a lot better. Then the next thing is, and again, on that personal point only, when you're talking about say the diary writing and all of that, it's a very interesting point to write, especially in the kind of circumstances we're living in, that, you know, you are into diary writing. So it will be nicer if you're like, one thing I saw that was a little lacking was some excitement there, because you have a hobby which we can talk about a lot. Anyone would want to know, okay, if she has as an interest, she writes a diary, so then what are the implications, etc. I found that excitement to be a little lacking on that. And again, taking things back to your personal experiences throughout the interview would help a lot more in understanding, you know, so the whole idea is that, one, as an individual, whenever you're in an interview, it's very important for people to see you as a person and not as just a candidate applying for a particular job, right?
Sure. Or
just coming out and giving an interview. So that is a little important. Do that. And one thing that I felt which was a little bit of a problem is also key. You kept suggesting behavioral changes in almost all answers, right? So that's always a long-term solve, right? So it's better to give short-term solves, more short-term solves, and kind of a lot of your answers are also sounding as if aap mains ka paper likh rahe ho. Mere paas 5 point hai, point number 1, point number 2, point number 3, point number 4, point number 5, right? In almost all answers, you were coming out as firstly, secondly, thirdly. Firstly, secondly, thirdly. Wo thoda, try sounding a little more spontaneous. Because otherwise, sab kuch aisa lagega jaise pura rat rata ke hum baithe hain. Theek hai, humne preparation bahut kiya hai. But it should not look like you're just hiding behind your preparation. So just that input. Everything else otherwise is wonderful. Okay? Take care. All the best.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Hi, Nupur.
Hello, ma'am.
Aditi ma'am has told a lot of things which I also wanted to tell you. So, first of all, your good point is that your confidence level is very good. So, keep up this momentum of your confidence. And she shared that, yes, you were calm throughout your interview. So that was a good point. And especially when you were giving certain, you know, solutions kind of thing, then you were quite good in that. So you were knowing ki, yes, this is the problem. And that's why you know the solution, right? Coming to your personal questions, like I asked you about a striking feature of empowering a woman. So that should be, you know, we should feel that it is connected to you. It should be very, like, it is coming through, it is coming from inside you, right? So that the person coming in, sitting in front of you is satisfied that, yes, whatever you are saying, it is true that you really want that thing, right? Because safety and security, it is good, no doubt. But the first and foremost thing, in my opinion, I think is the decision-making thing, right? Once you know that this is my decision and I'm eligible to take that decision equally as a man, then that will be a most important thing. And rather than coming to the, even to the decision-making, it should be the equality thing that should be there. So, jo cheeze personal level pe bahut acche se aap keh sakte ho, un cheezo ko thoda sa, you can take your interview in that direction. Right, तो थोड़ा सा वहाँ पे उन चीजों को पर्सनल लेवल वाली चीजों को यू कैन गिव अ मच बेटर पर्सपेक्टिव ऑन दैट राइट एंड
मिस इंटरप्रेटेड द क्वेश्चन दैट एम्पावरमेंट ऑफ वुमेन आई थॉट यू आर आस्किंग अबाउट द मेजर्स ऑफ द मोस्ट इम्पोर्टेंट स्टेप टू बी टेकन फॉर एम्पावरिंग वुमेन
fine, fine. It's okay. ठीक है. Okay. So second thing about your ACIU, two things. So prepare for that also, because since you are working, since you are training over, being a trainee over there, so questions will come on that, because I was not satisfied with the solutions which you gave, right? Mostly side, but you should have that terminologies, the standard operating procedures are there, NAT grid solution is there. So all these things should come in your answer, right? Because it's a possibility that there will be a question on this ACIU 2 thing, right? So on that basis, and your diary writing thing, it was very good. Some points which you said was very good, like telling them in their native language, that was a very good point. That was a very innovative point, right? So the diary writing should be very, matlab, you must be very prepared on that also, right? So
yes,
thank you. Himanshu sir.
Good. So first thing first, my intention was not to check your knowledge, because my other colleagues have checked your knowledge, and as they have told you, the knowledge wise it's perfect, confidence wise it's perfect. Now I'll come back to my game. So the reason of playing a game with you was not to test your knowledge. It was to test your mind. Reason being, we all have a primitive mind. We take decisions through our subconscious mind. And this will be the biggest challenge that you will face when you go to the field as a DM. The reason I told you that I don't know you, and now you have a lottery. Lottery is not something you have earned. You got it. And then I gave you an option of sharing it with me. It tells three things to me. One, your compassion. Other, your sense of justice. And the third thing which you have been talking around was inequality. It covers the three aspects. And when you say I will not share, it straight away tells me how your mind and your subconscious mind thinks. So that's one. So be strategic and be aware of all these things. These kind of situation can pop up, and I can play tens and tens of games with you to make sure what you actually think and what you're actually speaking, and can find out different. So three things I check, only three things: your sense of justice, because you talked about inequality, you talked about wealth tax, your sense, your mind when it comes to inequality, and your compassion. So just that, just work on that. Like when you, because see, once you become a DM, you will not be knowing the persons who are residing in that area, but you have to work from them. So compassion is important. Sense of justice is very important. You may not know them personally, but you have to work for them. So just keep these things in mind. That's it. Otherwise, it's perfect. Nothing from my side.
Okay, Nupur, before I switch to, move towards the questions and their answers and what I think, let me first talk about you, because, maybe the question that we have asked might not come handy there, but what would be the, strength of yours there is you. The way I see it, there's one problem in you, and that is you are really hard on yourself. You're trying too hard. Why? You're trying too hard. You don't need to, you are basically carrying your expectation on your shoulder. Even today, when we are talking to each other, in spite of knowing this fact, this is a mock, you're carrying that huge expectation of success on your shoulder. And that is very much getting reflected on your face. Come on, leave the monkey off your shoulder. Take it easy. That's the problem. Try to understand. That is about 20 to 40 marks. It can pull you down by 40 marks. It can give you 20 plus marks. You're expecting too much from yourself. Why? Try to understand. This is not a rejection process. You have left that part behind. Prelims is the rejection process. Mains is evaluation. This part is a selection process. nobody's going to, you know, drill you. Nobody's going to, you know, get into your head. Everybody would be talking as if, you know, it's a conversation. Don't go by this a psyche that, you know, you have to crack it. You got to get marks there. Otherwise, you know, there's a success and there's, don't get into that success and failure thing. That is very much there in your mind. You know why you are giving that particular type of answers, like mains answer? You want to be really correct. You want to be really correct in every question. You need to understand that's not what you are. Those answers are what is, you know, told to you. So that becomes, you know, clearly visible on your face. Come on, relax. When is your interview?
It's on 21st of July.
21st of July. Today is 12th, right? You have 10 days.
Yes.
Relax. See, you wrote your mains. Sure. And you know the answers. So in case they ask you questions like, you know, why Taliban is acting this way, why China is this way, Russia is this way, you'll be able to answer those questions. And trust me, they would not be grilling you. They just would be talking to you. And if you look back, that's the mistake that you have been committing in all these years. You were going to interview as if you got to snatch something out of them. That's not the way it happens. Just go and have a conversation with them. Be what you are. Otherwise, there will be a problem. Otherwise, definitely there will be a problem. Just go easy. I mean, like, you know, you're there. There are five, six people. Just have a conversation. See, we can't change ourselves. We just think that we can change ourselves. And, you know, we need to understand that those guys have got experience of 37, 40 years of experience. So they are really smart guys. Really smart. They talk real polite. You have experience of this, right? All those guys, I doubt they ever, rag you. They must have talked really polite to you, right? So you know this. You have got this experience. And then still you are committing the same mistake that you committed in your past three interviews. Come on, relax. You need to relax.
Yes, sir.
You know, that's very much on your face. You know, I don't need to talk to you, for half an hour to know about it. The kind of expression that you have right now on your face, it takes only 5 minutes to know that, you know, this girl is getting desperate. Just relax. Right? If you go relax, the kind of performance that you are expecting out of yourself, you'll get that. Now to bring that icing on the cake thing, let's talk about, you know, all those things, stuff like, you know, the questions that they would be asking and for your own satisfaction that I have given all the answers. See, what happens, you appear in an interview, you give, even if you don't give answer, and then you start getting the jitters. Even if you get marks after the interview, but then that comes, you know, after a month or two. But what happens in that interview, you start feeling like you are a loser. So this, you know, number of questions asked and number of answers given gives you confidence. So for that, let's talk about a couple of things. Otherwise, as far as personality and your preparedness is concerned, you are completely prepared. You're a complete package, except for one thing that is, you know, mountain on your shoulder. That's not going to help. So let's talk about all those, you know, small things. Diary writing, good thing. Read about a couple of really, really, you know, famous diaries of, say, start with Leonardo DiCaprio. Leonardo da Vinci, sorry. Leonardo da Vinci and then Anne Frank and all. There are five, six interesting diaries, which are quite famous. We didn't ask about your hobby of cooking. Yeah, dessert.
Yes.
So you got to prepare about that. Now, when you're giving answer to the questions, the answer that you give in mains is bound to be different here. So like when we talk about non-aligned movement, the paradigm has changed. You know, India was actually neglecting this non-aligned movement thing Only recently Prime Minister attended this meeting. Otherwise, India was not giving any respect to this, because India itself considered to be a pole of a multipolar world. So you need to refine your answer. You can, we can't say that, we want to show ourselves as non-aligned. Those marks are gone. I mean, nobody bothers about that. Everybody is thinking about their own, benefits. India still is in this non-aligned movement because India wants those votes from these countries in UN or at other platform, nothing else. As of now, nothing matters to India. Yes. India is with Russia, India is with America, everybody. And so is so are these countries. So that way, those non-aligned things are gone. Now, one more thing. When I was talking about this NGT thing and charging them about penalties and all. See, in Mainz, you can very well say that. Here, you can put certain, you understand. They were given an opportunity. Constitution talks about that protests should be peaceful. Supreme Court has said that you cannot disturb public life and public order and all. And everything was actually disturbed. Everything was disturbed. I'm not saying that you should accept my answer, but if I were asked this question, I probably would have said that this thing should have been evaluated. Because, if they have got so much of faith in the rightness of their protest, government had given them alternate place. There, rather than, putting everybody in pain, they should have tried to create a mass movement. After all, there are people who have used this method to get into power also, without naming him. Yeah, without naming him. But then you can say that, people have garnered support of people by following a path. They probably could have. I personally do not support their method.
Penal.
So, yeah, because, that actually was, they created lots of chaos to the people. Now, the second question about the lockdown thing, I personally say this, buy this idea of 1 month lockdown, but then, yeah, I agree with your point also, but the answer would be slightly different. You can say that in India, forget about the world, in India, we have about 340 million people who are below poverty line. They could barely sustain every day's requirement. If we go for 1 month lockdown, it's not only about the food. There are other requirements also.
Yes.
If those are met, maybe we can go for lockdown. Otherwise, it's not sustainable. It is advisable, not sustainable is the thing. So these are just answers. You may be asked questions or not. I'm telling you these answers because I'm just trying to give you to mold your mental frame. How exactly should you go about? But these are minor things. Only 10 to 20% thing. The 80% solution of 80% of your problems lies with you, not with us. So you need to sort out this here in your brain. So when you're going inside UPSC, think about larger thing. These are, short-term things. When you start looking at the larger picture, you don't get jitters. And if you don't get jitters, you get marks, right? So best of luck from my side.
Thank you, sir.